He's my senior fellow. He's do some work for the OCT, and we also have two training from our local hospital. And we are very happy to have this opportunity to transfer our live demo to this great meeting. And today we have prepared two cases. One is done by me. It's a very complicated cases. We did it by transradial approach. Another case lab was Dr. Zhou. He's my also the senior attending and also the director of a cardiac case lab. And he will do a CTO cases translated approach.
Excellent, excellent. We had a we had a meeting in Budapest.
Yeah, we know.
Yes.
Yeah, I know.
So this is a nice city, and everybody enjoy themselves.
Yeah.
So someone's not wake up yet, but we are here about 8 o'clock in the morning. Let me introduce my panel to you. To my left hand side is a Dr. Gill.
Thank you. Good morning.
I'm from Poland.
Good morning.
Also. Yeah, Dr. Gil from Poland and Dr.
Hi, good.
Oliver Connor.
Hello.
Sorry. Yeah.
Hello. I'm from Lund, Sweden.
From Sweden, Oliver
good.
Connor.
Good to see you. Good
and
to hear you.
Roberts.
Yeah.
Good morning, Jonathan Roberts from Florida.
Excellent. So we international faculty here. So can we listen to a case?
Yes, great panel,
Let's start.
Yes. Yeah, I asked Dr. Jin to introduce the cases we did today, and we also go ahead with the film, and he will go ahead.
Good morning, everyone. The case is a 76 years old male patient, and he come to our hospital with a chief complaint as we can't just pay for over 2 years. And he has received a RCA PCI just 1 month ago in his local hospital. And he come here, he also have a hypertension for over 10 years. And now his physical examination is normal, no marked signs. And ECG finding is there is a ST depression with T-wave inversion in lead V4 to V6. And his echo is shows normal. His EGFR is normal, and he with a hypercholesterol. So today our target lesion is going to do the LCA, and we first we are planning to do the intravascular image with OCT, and we also prepare the rota if necessary.
Yes. So these our cases is 76 at 76 years old gentleman. He actually is a three vessel disease and. He's an advanced age and also have a lot some other lesions. He's refused to take bypass surgery. So he get advanced me 1 month ago, and I since the right coronary artery is the proximal and osteo lesions, so I asked the local doctor to fix the first right coronary first. And now he come to our hospital. We did the angiogram translated approach with six flange from right radial artery. And we did angiogram for the right coronary artery. It's a great result. And I think the two stent in the Bronx part and very good result. And the flow is good, the distal vessel is good.
Can we see the angio? We cannot see it. Oh, yes.
Yeah, I have the film. Can you see it?
No, good.
Have see it?
Yes.
Have it?
Yes, we see that.
My personal image should be really small. Yeah, good. So it's a right coronary artery. It's a very good standing result 1 month ago. And we did two. And then with the left coronary artery, it's very diffuse. Disease, I think it's left me, it's relatively good. And the proximal part of circumflex is a little bit, I think it's quite good still, but in the middle part, there's a very severe stenosis and the TME flow is about 2, not 3, I think. And the LD proximal, it seems a little bit good. But the there's this two big diagonal branch and a diffuse disease. And from the image, we can see there's a lot of calcification.
You think the left main is normal? I see there's some blockage in the left main and some calcium.
Definitely. Yes. There is this caudal spider view. And this is the angiogram today. So I need to discuss with all our panel and maybe from the audience attending. Need I show the film again?
Okay, let me ask my panel, see what we think they should proceed, and we can go back to you. I think we see everything. Let's start with Dr. Gill.
So this is a very good manifestation of multivessel disease, the very diffuse atherosclerotic process in these coronaries. Personally, I would start with EFR, FFR measurements, taking it into account that's not that the all lesions are really functionally significant. So therefore, I personally believe that at least three stents should be used, definitely for proximal mid LAD, then two stents for circumflex, for distal, and for proximal part, and then you have to take care also on a marginal, which is important branch for this lady. Anyway, I love, these techniques as OCT or IVUS, but in terms of physiology, I would use FFR assessment.
Okay. So would you use them both, yes, FFR than OCT?
If you sponsor
I think for the circumflex, I think definitely it's a slow flow, and I think we just directed that can directly fix the vessel. But for the right corner LAD lesions, it's need to FFR to make decision we need to intervention or not.
I believe you are right in terms of distal lesion, but in terms of proximal, I'm not pretty sure.
Okay. Yeah, yes. Yes.
Right. How about the bifurcated lesions? What kind of technique are you going to do, Dr. Gill?
The typical
approach in Europe is according to European Bifurcation Club recommendations, provisional T-stenting. Mm. So I'm pretty sure that one stent for main vessel, I mean circumflex artery, it's enough. So might be additional one. If additional one, the most fashionable right now is TAP technique, which is a modification of T-stenting, but. In both situations, mm-hmm. I mean in LAD diagonal and in a circumflex marginal, we can use these two techniques.
Okay, let's go to Dr. Oliver Connor.
So this looks like it's going to be a while in a cath lab with a number of stents here, but I agree with my colleague Robert Gill that FFR is certainly useful here to assess some of the vessels that may not need to be treated. And then if you want to check afterwards with OCT or IVUS, you may or may want to do, especially absolutely if you do the left main. And I don't think that we're completely clear on the left main yet. And I agree also that it's provisional stenting for the side branches.
Yeah, I think the left main will turn out to be a little bit funny here. Dr. Roberts?
I agree with Dr. Olaf Kronov. This is going to be a long case in the cath lab, many stents. And I think surgery is probably, I know the patient refused surgery, but there's multiple bifurcations. This is going to be, I think surgery may have been a better long-term option in this patient, but we're here in the cath lab. So I agree that I think better characterizing the left main is going to be important to know whether, because in this view right here, the left main looks okay, and do you just put the stents right up to the ostium of the LAD or not. But I think FFR to assess the side branches to see, and I think provisional stenting for the diagnosis I think we're going to get away without doing the diagonals, but maybe not. I think we're going to be doing bifurcating stenting in the circumflex system.
Good. Olivier Bertrand's here. You want to say hi to Dr. Fu?
Hello, good morning, Dr. Fu.
Hello, good morning, Olivia.
Hi.
Great to hear you.
Always a great thing to have crazy cases from China, and we are very grateful that you choose to do something very difficult.
Yeah.
So I would basically, I'm also a big fan of using physiology in order to plan the intervention, because here you know when you're going to start, you have no idea when you're going to finish. So I like to use physiology, and now I'm also starting to use post-PCI FFR to try to understand and assess acutely the results. So definitely, I mean, you know it's going to be positive for the circ and marginal, but I would suspect it's going to be positive as well on the LED.
Yeah, thank you, Olivia. It's a great suggestion. Yes, I think it's the physical evaluation is very, very important for kind of these cases. But today, since I need to definitely intervention the circumflex, so the LED and from angiogram, I think it seems we need to do intervention. So we have two choice: one is FFR and another is OCT. But you know, for one cases we. Sometimes it's very difficult to make decision choice which one to do. You know, both will be better, but some it's cost a lot. And so for these cases, we use choice is the OCT to evaluate the calcification and so on, what is needed intervention or not intervention. So before the our strategy today is that we did OCT first. And then we make other decision to do that. It's actually when the OCT guide cathode is in, the flow is get very, very slow. And maybe because from the torture vessel, but definitely it's a proximal part that have very severe stenosis. So later we show you the OCT result. Dr. Jing, please. So we show you the OCT results. Can you see the OCT image on the screen?
Yes, we see.
Yeah, good. Go ahead. Yeah.
Just a small comment. So we know there is some literature in terms of cutoff criteria for IVUS, but unfortunately for OCT we don't have clear measurements, say values for the cutoff criteria. So it's
yes.
This is a very painful.
Yeah. It's good comment. I think we know it's a go ahead did a kind of study. It's about use the OCT to evaluate the calcification, try to get some data how to introduction the use of OCT guiding FFR loader result. So we did the OCT and just to try to evaluate the calcification and so on.
We rely on the method of common sense. It looks like it's significant stenosis.
Yeah.
It looks bad, it's bad.
You think? It looks, the left maze looks quite good, but yeah, from the distal AD, I think we know the negative.
So my from my
this very this 270 degree calcification. I personally think the OCT sometimes is better for the evaluation of the calcification, since he can see the beyond the calcification, and there's the plaque, the characteristic of plaque. So like these cases, we can clearly see the 180 degree of 一个个症方法.
Yeah.
Like this place, it's a very clear classification.
Here we can see the.
That's a proximal. That's a proximal. Yeah. It's a prompt LD, yeah. Okay. It's proximal LD, yeah. The mark 30 is at the left of me. I think it's 20 to 30 20, left of me. It's a very. I think here's a very in the from the 6 to 11 as 10 degree as a clock it's a really thick classification and from 11 to 3 o'clock it's a really not so thick classification and also there's a lot of classification in the almost 300 degree.
May I have a question to you? You know that the newest version of CT machine from St. Jude has a co-registration. So it means that simultaneously with OCT images we can see the position of the probe. So I guess you don't have this option in your machine.
Yeah, still not available.
Because it's very difficult for us to understand.
Yeah.
Where is the image from? So therefore, could you explain exactly the position? And because looking at the at the IVUS and OCT, I would say that the body of left main is fine. But what about the orifices of circumflex and LAD? So this is a kind of equivalent of left main disease.
It's a kind of disease. Yeah, we tried to show you the osteo of circumflex. Just seconds, yeah. I think here is the circumference, osteo circumference. I think here is the osteo circumference. It seems the osteo circumference is good. I think it's wide enough. Yeah. It's
yeah. Mm.
So for this kind of classification, we try to plan to use a lot to treat this. One is to try to get good results of the stent and easy to be expanded of stent. So we plan to do a lot in the LED, but you know the flow of circumflex is not good. So we try to before the do the lot of LED, we need to fix the circumflex first to keep the good flow of the heart and so on. So we use the we did the stent of circumflex first. We dilated with 2.20 balloon, and it seems that there's a lot of dissection. I think this kind of dissection will very easily cause the occlusion of the side branch.
I did not see you protect the OM. Do you want to protect the OM?
Yeah.
I did not see a wide.
Yeah. And we tried to use the field FC to levy the OM, but since the proximate a lot of dissection, it's always go to the dissection. So we use the like this is very very. Difficult to rewire, so we use a crew set to rewire the OM vessel, and it's become very very easy. You know the wires come and very easy to go to the OM.
So this is a trained microcatheter you use, right? Close.
Yeah, it's a crew set. Microcatheter two. Double lumen
microcatheter. I see.
And got a microcatheter, yeah.
That's very nice.
And then we wire. Yeah, it's sometimes very work. And so we dial it again, but still very difficult to we measure the deletion. I think so we need a very long stent from proximal to distal 38, something like that. So we try use the stent, but it's really difficult to pass, and we dilate again. And
what kind of balloon you use?
Stent can be
deployed. What size of balloon?
It 2.20.
2 times 20.
220, yeah.
Dr. Fu, did you try to dilate the ostium of the marginal branch prior putting a stent or not?
Yes, I a little worry about if you dilate with a balloon, maybe cause dissection and cause the levier very difficult. And so I think we keep the wire will be good enough, already enough, I think.
So I fully agree with you. This is, again, the next recommendation of European Bifurcation Club, just to avoid predilatation of side branch in terms of possible bed dissections. Then if you really believe in provisional T-stenting approach, this is a good decision.
But on the other hand...
So we try to... Deploy stand is very difficult. It can't pass this long stand, so we have to use the Godzilla to assist them to deliver this stand. And we fix it and stand, and it looks, but definitely the OM is lost. And so we use the new wire to rewire it. It's not so difficult, but it takes time. We rewire the OIM.
Which wire did you use to recross, Dr. Fu? Which wire do you use to recross?
Field FC.
Field FC. Do you try to do a part first before you rewire? Part.
Excuse me?
Do you try to optimize the plasma part before you rewire?
Yeah.
When you lost a side branch,
yeah,
I think the European people recommend do a part first.
Yeah. Yeah, we post-dilate first, and when maybe good result, and then we rewire. Maybe sometimes it will be getting better. Since you know, if it stand in not good position, maybe the new the wire will be go to the main vessel dissection subintimal and cause the dissection of the side branch. I take time sometimes and to rewire. It's quite good. I quite believe my handling the wire. So we pass the wire, and we did post dilate, and with the 2.5 non compliant balloon, and with the 1.5 Tatsuna 1.5 balloon, did try to open the stent structure a little bit and did the kissing. And then this is the final result of a circumflex. And the proximal part seems not optimal, but you know, the main vessel we today try to treat is the AAD lesions. So we leave the circumflex at like this situation. Do you agree with that?
I think so. I think you do the the left main may need to fix. So you need to do a two stand if there's a left main there. So I will lift the circ at this moment and see what you finish the LED first.
Yeah.
And you decide the left main issue.
Yes.
So this situation shows us that physiological assessment has a big advantage over the, let's say, OCT or IVUS in such a situation, because we know that the length of the stents impact the late outcome of the patient. So the spot stenting is again very fashionable right now, and I, as my colleague said, I would stop in this moment trying to fix LAD and diagonal branches, looking at the situation and without FFR measurements, I wouldn't, and other direction dissections, I wouldn't touch during this stage the circumflex artery.
I'll make a comment, which is sometimes, or most of the time, I don't like to proceed as opinion-based, but I have become very fond of the marginal branch. To me, is the artery, the branch that may make the patient very symptomatic. I mean, I think they are worse than having a diagonal in the same situation. But from marginal and having the ostium bother me since the beginning, I would probably do what I do. I mostly completely avoid to put any stent on a side branch. But in this case, when there was very significant disease, I would probably finish with a drug-eluting balloon just to treat the ostium. That's my routine practice for side branch ostium when there is a significant disease that got worse after the stent implantation on the proximal part. And the second point is that I agree with you that you have to stick to your plan, obviously, but before deciding that I will leave the circumflex proximally alone, I would just do the angio without any wire in place before deciding.
Yeah, I agree, Oliver. I think we just leave the first test since we need to do the load in the LED. So we take out the wire and from different positions, it looks quite good. And so we, drug-eluting balloon, I also agree with that. But, you know, it's quite expensive in China. It's almost double price of one stent, drug-eluting stent. So it's a little bit limitation for what we use for these kind of cases. I actually interesting to do a study with the drug-eluting balloon and also with the small vessel disease. But it takes time. So I think we may go ahead to discuss with that. And so we change it to a loader wire to the LED and use 1.5 loader there's some very, very thick lesions, I think. It's just in the proximal of LED. But so it's not so difficult. We pass two times.
So you went directly with the 1.5? You didn't try the 125 first? Directly with the 1.5?
Yeah, after the loader, and we did the OCT, we showed the OCT result. Is there some, I think maybe we will get some result from OCT.
Kananama. Have you get the OCT?
Can you see the OCT image?
Yes, we see.
Yeah.
But you know,
loaded the proximal part.
If you let me comment on that. You know, I have some doubts because, yeah. First of all, looking at the OCT, I saw in the most calcific spots, there was an arc very big, around 180 degrees. But in terms of lumen, that was over 2 millimeters. So if you start with 2.5 or 225, you just very gently slow down to the LED without any effect on calcific plaque. So this is always a problem when we have a big calcific load with a pretty big lumen. And then in such a situation, just to debulk or to modify the plaque, you are forced to use a bigger bore, bigger than even 175. So I'm pretty sure that you will proceed with the case even without calcific, without a rota, because the calcific arc was not bigger than 180 degrees.
Yes, I agree. Your comment. It's definitely it's true. But you know, the loader go ahead. Usually, we are not always coexist with the vessel. So definitely, you touch parts of the calcified plaque and modify the characteristics of the plaque. So we, from the OCT, we can see there's a lot of, you know, from OCT, the 3 degree and so on. They have a lot of, before the loader, they have very calcification, but now you have some modify of the circumference, like this position is, I think it's very clear.
I agree with you, Dr. Fu. I think 1.5 per probably is okay, just modify a little bit. But let me hear another panel said this opinion about the birth sign.
Yeah.
Dr. Oliver Connor and Dr. Roberts.
I think I would avoid using it
here. FC
is my personal opinion.
Because it's a six French guide, we obviously have some limitation. The most you can get is a 175 in some six French guides. So I have no problem with a 1.5 and to modify the lesion, and hopefully it will change the compliance so you can expand it.
Okay. So this is six French guide, right? Dr. Fu?
Six French guide, yeah, yes. Six French, yes.
So after the rotor, you do another OCT?
Yeah, with the afterload OCT is on screen. You see the crossing parts have some debulking of the operation of the calcification, like this position. You have seen it. This is after.
So why you do another OCT after rotor? What is the what kind of decision making you doing? You are not.
I just try to show you. I was actually conduct a study about use the OCT to evaluation the results of the rotor.
After the rotational atherectomy,
it's really,
what's your strategy?
Yeah.
Are you going to go with a non-compliant balloon, or just what are you going to do next?
Yeah, we rewire the second diagonal, and then we use the 2-point non-compliant balloon to dilate the vessel, and then see what's happened. So I think I go ahead do the PCI for the next procedure, and then we'll come back to show you our final results. And there's another cath lab where Dr. Zhou is almost finished. He's the CTO cases, so maybe we transfer the next cath lab.
Hello.
Hey.
Hi.
Hello. Hi.
Hello, cath lab number two. Can you hear us?
Yeah. Yeah, I can hear.
Yes.
Yeah. Hello, everyone.
Hi. Can you introduce your team, yourself?
Okay.
And the case?
I'm Dr. Zhou, and my assistant is Dr. Zhang and Dr. Song. Now I ask Dr. Zhang to introduce my case briefly.
Good morning, gentlemen. This one is one female patient, and she's age about 76 years old, and she complains about the chest pain for 6 months and worse for 1 month. And she has hypertension for over 30 years and not controlled well. His physical examination is well, and the echo show the EF is normal, about 78%, and GFR is normal, the ALDOC is normal, and she has experienced the angiogram in the art hospital and showed the CTO lesion at the right artery, and no, this case procedure is to open the CTO lesion of the right artery.
About 3 months ago, the local hospital, they tried to open the ICA, but they failed. Now 3 months later, we did a coronary angiogram. This is a coronary angiogram. I will show you. Transradial branch, ICA showed. Can you see the film?
Yes, we still.
ICA in total occluded, and this is ICA, and in the middle and the proximal part of the ICA, there's some lesion. There's a left coronary angiogram showed nearly normal. So, we did several view to see there is some collateral from left from AOE from septal channel. There is no obvious channel I can find. Would you like to tell me about what's your strategy of this CTO lesion PCI?
So there is no left. My strategy, so there's no left to right collateral. We can see there's a the right there's a collateral from the Cronus branch or SA, that's a Cronus branch collateral.
My strategy is I want to do it by anticoagulator approach first, and if failed, I will do leachoagulator approach.
Your primary strategy is using the Y escalation first. What kind of wire you using now?
Yeah. Because at a local hospital, they had performed the procedure already. I found some dissection also there. So at first, I just use guide three with microcatheter spot.
Three. Okay.
This is guide three. The micro cast.
You're using micro cast support?
Yes, for you. Yeah, guide three. Okay. So now I will pull out the micro cast. I will use parallel Y technique with closed support. Double closed.
Now it's closed. Why you pick up the guy three instead of guy second or guy first? This always your approach. Go into the third guy third.
Because I think it's field ST is not feasible in this patient. Because so it's why is very easy to enter the fourth lumen. So I should try to puncture, the advanced Y from fourth lumen to true lumen. So I should use stiff Y. My strategy, my experience is use, in this situation, I will use the stiff Y, just like Conquest Pro, Guide 3, or Class Progress 140T, such wise. So I will now is a parallel Y technique. So I use, but in that situation, the Y is not in the true lumen. I think is out of the now is. It seems in the true lumen. Seems in the true lumen. Because of the distal vessel is very, very small. It's difficult for me to enter to advance Y into the distal true lumen. But I think it is in the true lumen.
So my
that's why it's in the true lumen.
What I'm seeing before is you have two Y there, right? Two Y.
Yeah.
Both of them is a guide three.
Yeah.
Both of them, guide three.
All of them is guide three.
Guide three.
All the two Y's are guide three. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The same. Now I'll pull out the closet and dilate the vessel, and then I advance the microcatheter to replace the guy 3. I use soft Y. But now we can see the IVUS.
But looks like you re-entry the Y is a very distal, right? In a very distal vessel.
It seems, but yeah. But the IVUS showed is in the after the IVUS examination, we found that it is in the true lumen.
Yeah.
Please see. Please transfer. The IVUS, yeah.
Yeah, this is a very distal small vessel, and we use the vacanal eagle eye because the distal vessel is very small. The Boston eyelid cannot be crossed, I think. So we use the eagle eye. The eagle eye, after reading down, the vessel is very small, and we can only see the cast here. And this is the manual pullback. And here we can see one small side branch coming. So we think here is the true lumen here. And after that, this vessel is still very small. And here we can see another small vessel coming and much bigger. Yeah. So at this time, it can confirm this is in the true lumen. And we dilate the vessel with the 2-point yellow balloon. And here's the proximal. There's a, yeah, here's the one big and was here and a small. Yeah, one side branch here. Okay.
Now, after dilation, the 2.0 balloon dilation, I did the angiogram. Now this, it seems in the true lumen, and the IVUS confirmed, and it was confirmed before, so confirmed by the IVUS. So I dilated again with 2.5 below in the paroxysmal CTO part, and then with nitrogram, and it seems better. It seems better, but the distal part of the vessel is too small. It's only 1.5, so it's very difficult for me to put a stent. Would you give me some advice how to put the stent in this situation? I think the patient's vessel condition is not good.
So how much nitro you gave?
Nitro, 200 microgram one time. I have given him nitrogram for several times, maybe at least five times.
So the vessel is still the same, still very small. Looks like you're...
Yeah. But in the distal is small, but in the, during the, before the bifurcation, bifurcation, I think, is 2.5 milligram.
Let me comment on the IVUS images what we saw. So I'm very very cautious whether the distal Y position is the right one, because if you look at the beginning of the pullback, that was a manual pullback, we don't see really the vessel. It's very difficult to say whether you are really in true lumen or not. So my strategy in such a situation is to repeat the IVUS after predilatation. Then you can assess whether the position of the Y is fine. Could you really stent? Because if I look and in some of images, I have some doubts on that. especially for distal position. So therefore, this is the reason that the size of the distal vessels is so small.
We have also one question from or comment from the audience, please.
Yeah, good morning. There are two things I would like to comment. First of all, I think this is a typical retrograde approach situation usually, because you initially had a trifurcation with an distal cap ending exactly at the crux cordis. And what we currently see, there's only one side branch left, and what I see is that you lost the two side branches. That means you lost the right interventricular artery. And if you aim for a physiological or anatomically correct reconstruction of the vessel, you've got only one out of three vessels that you are currently in. And I completely agree. I don't think that you're in the true lumen in the distal part, because this looks like you are subintimal, and from the IVUS image, I think you're subintimal as well. So in this case, I would never advise to stent at the crux right now, because once you stent it, you seal the three other vessels.
So in summary, I believe that here people are not completely convinced that the wire is correctly positioned inside the vessel distally, based on the IVUS imaging and based on the fact that we only see one branch now instead of three.
So I repeat the IVUS again. Would you like to show them the film? So I will, because I think that most part of the PTO body is chewing. So I put I put one stent, but I will use 2.5 millimeter stent with very low pressure. So the nominal pressure of the stent is only 2. So I dilated it for 2 minutes. And for the two stent now. Yeah. I will show you the results. But the PDA is lost. There is some dissection in the ostium of the ICA. The dissection. So I want to cover the ostium of the ICA.
Looks like this vessel is very small. The flow is not that great. I think the stent may not be sustained for long term. Is anything happened or?
No problem. Because during the procedure, I had caused the heart rate.
The heart rate a little bit low.
Pardon? No problem. I was sure that there is some dissection in the ICA, ostium of the ICA.
How is the patient doing? I mean, does the patient feel any pain? Is it
stable.
Bradycardic or something?
No.
Patient is stable.
Yeah, very stable. No problem. Very stable. Because Before the procedure, the light, the just part of the vessel is too small. So it is very, very suitable PCI case for the, for so, this, suitable, is a very suitable case for CTO open, or open the case.
So you can, you can work on your case, you concentrate work on that, and then you can let us know later on, right, if you need more time. Maybe you can go back to operation room one. Let's see Dr. Fu.
Okay. Sure.
All right. Can we go back to operation room one?
Sure.
So let Dr. Cole work on this patient so we can go back to you.
Okay, thank you.
Is Dr. Fu there?
Are we on time? Are we on time? Are we on time? Yeah, charge.
So for the sake of time, we need to close the live case, and maybe we will come back during the session to see the final result, because we are already 15 minutes late. So I want to thank you very much, both of you, in Hangzhou, and it's always a pleasure to see a very complicated case. So we need to cut the live transmission, Dr. Fu, and we will come back just a bit later, because we have already lost, we have late for 15 minutes. So we'll come back in about maybe half an hour when both cases are finished, and you tell us how it went, okay?
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yes, yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. This our...
everybody for this fourth session. So I will have the big pleasure to do it, to chair this session with Dr. Vidovic. And we have as a panelist Dr. Babunashvili, Rigat Kieri, and Tiso Marcos and Villano. So the first presentation will be transradial access for IVUS guided left main PCI from Dr. Gilles. Thank you for coming, and thank you for respecting time.
Thank you very much for inviting me, giving the opportunity to share my experience on transradial access for left main treatment under the guidance of IVUS. This is my disclosure statement. I would like to start with some facts that coronary bifurcations, first of all, this is a challenge for contemporary interventionalists. We started to treat more and more bifurcations, among them left main, distal left main as well. We know about all of the potential complications, and we know that the results are not so good as for striate lesions. So this is a variety of anatomy, physiology. There are no really the same bifurcations for sure. There are no two identical bifurcations, I would say. As a part of bifurcations, we have to take into account left main disease, also with variety of anatomical and physiological presentations. Just a couple of words, why radial approach? First of all, it's relatively easy for trained interventionalists. We are not forced to use Allen test, which was necessary at the beginning of the history with this access. As an outcome of this technique, there is a big benefit, let's say some benefits on this technique in terms of decreasing bleeding and access complications. And it transfers also to the decrease of 30 days mortality and total final MACE rate. On the other hand, we know since the work of Professor Park from South Korea that that guidance of IVUS for left main stenting gives much more chances for better late outcome of these patients. So therefore, according to recommendations of European Society of Cardiology, IVUS is recommended to assess severity and optimize treatment of unprotected left main lesions. This is class recommendation 2A on level B. On the other hand, according to the next publications on this topic, we know that we should follow not only the minimal lumen cross-section area within the left main, but we should consider the left main as a construction of three parts. And this formula 8765 is most important to with good optimal position of the stents. It should be taken into consideration in terms of late outcome. So, therefore, my five radial should be a default approach. Right radial approach is ergonomically more favorable, associated with lower radiation. Left radial may be preferable for post-CABG patients, challenging right coronary artery interventions, and poor Allen test may not be prohibitive. It's great, but in my institution, we prefer left radial access, which is default approach. Some clinical data on that. Here you see the results of BIOS. I will show you later on. This is bifurcation dedicated stent. The results of clinical program on clinical program on that, and you can appreciate the ratio between radial access and femoral access during these studies. So we started with expert version. You see that 70 to 30% that was at the beginning, but at the end with Polbos 2 randomized trial, we came to 80 to 20. This is important for Polbos 1, for BIOS group, we enrolled much more left main cases. So therefore, the femoral access a little bit in increased. This is the reason. Then in terms of contrast media volume, you can appreciate that in these two randomized trials, there was a decreasing amount of contrast medium. We started 4 years ago with the Polbos 1, that was 180 as an average, but in Polbos 2, which we completed 1.5 years ago, that was 120. So it means that with the experience, increasing experience with this new bifurcation dedicated stents, gave us opportunity to decrease the contrast volume as well the radiation, but this I will show you later on. If you look at the left main and non-left main cases, you can appreciate that for left main cases, operators, that was multi-center randomized studies, needed more significantly, or let's say that was a trend for bigger amount of contrast volume for left main cases. But also you can appreciate the decreasing amount according to experience with this particular stent. So, but what we discovered? We discovered that with IVUS usage, it easily decreases the contrast medium about 2 millimeters. In terms of fluoroscopy time, you can appreciate that we also decrease the time of fluoroscopy, but for left main cases, we needed significantly much more radiation. On one hand, this is strange, but this is the truth. This is a practical results. What we discovered with IVUS, according to our calculations, IVUS shortened the fluoroscopy time on average about 3 minutes. So it means that you can, with IVUS, you can decrease amount of contrast medium, at least 20 milliliters, and at least three minutes of fluoroscopy time. And then if you take into consideration the optimization of the results, it impacts also the late patient's outcome. So therefore, we should use as much as possible. Unfortunately, this technique is costly. Some words about the technique which is used, the radial approach in my institution. So we use this 1 centimeter above stellate process insertion of the stainless steel wire. So this is nothing new, but we prefer bar needle than Teflon sheeted needle. We stick through. We just use so-called anterior puncture here. Some slides. How does it look like? What is very important? We started with radial cocktail at the beginning. We started with radial access more than 12 years ago. Right now we use only nitrates and unfractionated heparin during our procedures. In terms of coronaries, because we prefer left radial access, we use typical guides as for femoral approach. So in terms of radial specific catheters, only around 3% of cases. We don't believe that it's necessary to use in every single case strong guides. So it's operator dependent decision. In terms of additional techniques giving us better support, this is only the special techniques, as you see here, guide extensions, anchoring, or bigger guides. It's just around 3% percent cases. I would like to show you two very illustrative cases. So this is right coronary artery with some distal atherosclerosis, but not scheduled for the procedure. But you can appreciate the distal left main and diffuse atherosclerosis in the whole left coronary artery systems. This was accepted for percutaneous approach. Here you see the results of pre-procedural IVUS assessment. What is very important, there is a kind of approach that if you decide, so this is a formula for the assistants in my institution, so if you decide to use IVUS, this is obligatory to start with pre-procedural assessment. Of course, because it gives very, very important information which should impact the decision on protocol, on balloon stent sizes, length, and so on. However, there are also cases where operator doesn't plan at the beginning to use IVUS, but because of some problems with the angiographic images interpretation, that the IVUS or OCT is necessary. Anyway, that was a pretty difficult case with distal left main involvement, and also the plaque distribution from circumflex and LAD into the left main. And here this is a stent which was what was mentioned a couple of minutes ago. This is a bifurcation dedicated stent. This is old version with sirolimus elution. Some words, this stent gives us possibility to reconstruct anatomy of the bifurcation. Stent is placed on on a bottle-shaped balloon. This old version, this previous version, had stack thickness 120 millimeters, so very good for calcific and fibrotic lesions, however not for small vessels. How does it work? Just there are three markers: the mid marker of the balloon, delivering balloon, should be placed at the tip of carina. So this is relatively easy positioning. Here you see that this stent was extensively investigated, a lot of publication on that, and this is not true that this mid portion of the stent gives us opportunity of restenosis. This is a proof of that. Here you can appreciate the results of two versions of this particular stent: expert with paclitaxel elution and limb with sirolimus elution. You can appreciate that 12-month results with a MACE are the best in the class, I would say. What is very important should be stated that there was 95% of angiographic control for these cases. So it means this is not angina inducing TLR, but angiographic restenosis. So taking into account, these are very good result. And then continuation of the case, two balloon dilatations. I would say that angiographic results was great, but we know that this is imagination. Here you see the bioslim positioning, you see the mid marker which should be placed on the tip of carina, in implantation of the stent, and then you see the result with the preservation of the circumflex artery orifice with a very good blood perfusion in two projections. Then proximal optimization technique with the bigger balloon, because that was 3.75, then 404 redilatation, then final results, additional dilatation for circumflex artery, then kissing, that final kissing for LAD and circumflex artery, then post-procedural IVUS assessment. Here you can appreciate that we got all of the kank. Cutoff criteria, so therefore we are very happy on that. If you look at the proximal circumflex artery, the result was not 5, but was below 5, but that was not significant, functionally significant lesion, therefore we decided to stop the procedure. Here the final result. But right now we have a newer version of this stent, which is a thin strut stent, comparable to the best in the regular drug-eluting stent, with 70 micrometers strut thickness, with biodegradable polymer and sirolimus concentration 1.4 microgram per square millimeters. And then you can appreciate a next case with this newest version of BIOS. You can appreciate that was intermediate lesion for distal left main. There was also a problem of mid LAD, and then pretty good right coronary system, already capable of 3 years later, earlier treated with two stent implantation. Here you see the pre-procedural IVUS data. Forgive me the small numbers which you cannot see from your positions. However, believe me that the distal left main was below, let's say, minimal lumen cross sectional area for the distal left main was below 6 millimeters. So therefore, we decided to treat the patient. We started with mid LAD. After predilatation, we implant 29 millimeters chromium cobalt sirolimus eluting stent with 14 atmospheres. Here you can appreciate very good result with very good flow. And then we decided to predilate left main with NC30 balloon 40 millimeters length, and then positioning of the stent. And then I would like to bring your attention to the first slide on the left. That was a mistake of the nurse, who started to inflate the balloon in the moment of stent positioning. So I was pretty sure that it will be a disaster. But finally, you can appreciate that result was pretty good. However, the inflow for second flex artery not ideal. Then predilatation, we see still a kind of indentation and haziness in the orifice of circumflex artery. Then two balloons in inflation with 30 balloons, and then third next stent for circumflex artery in a tap technique that was not typical tap, however, because there was not simultaneous inflation of the balloon. Anyway, the final result was at least acceptable, but we still see the indentation in the orifice of circumflex artery. So in my mind, that was a reason of this shift of the stent and part of the distal part of the stent, let's say, looked at the orifice of circumflex artery. So therefore, again, redilation of these two vessels, LAD and circumflex artery. So you can appreciate indentation within the circumflex artery. And this is final result, much better than it was at the beginning. So therefore, we decided to stop. You see the distance between bio stent and the mid portion of the stent. However, we decided to use OCT just to be completely sure how does the struts looks at the orifice of circumflex artery. And you can appreciate that minimal lumen cross-section area for LAD where was the kind of restenosis, but was almost 5 square millimeters. And then we achieved all of the criteria by Kang, telling us that was optimal implantation. However, you can appreciate on this. On the left position, MLA 790.92 square millimeters, you can appreciate the very very short protrusion of the distal part of the biostent into the circumflex artery. But that was something, let's say, more than 1 millimeter, less than 2 millimeters, using the caliper of CT. So therefore, we decided to start. Then this is the completion of the case. And just to conclude, that the IVUS application, the course of PCI treatments on the left main stem cases, beside the improvement of the patient's late outcome, is taking effects, shortening the duration of the treatment. Reduction of the used contrast media and reduction of the time of fluoroscopy. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. I think we'll just skip the questions because we're a little bit late, but I think this really shows very nicely how a dedicated bifurcation stent is quite nice in left. So our next speaker is Dr. Briniarski, and we'll talk about the transradial axis for complex coronary CTO intervention.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the invitation for this important meeting. It's okay. In such beautiful city of Budapest, I would like to show you briefly the transradial access for complex coronary procedures. 4 years ago, during one of my lectures, Manos Bilakis from the United States said that if you see two long-armed sheets introduced by the femoral approach, this is the sign of good CT operator. The question is, is this still valid? We have the basic toolkit for CTOPCI, and in the previous year, the many of new devices, also imaging modalities and retrograde approach was introduced, but in this slide we cannot see anything about the approach. We can choose during our intervention between the radial access, between femoral. We can do also by the bifemoral, biradial, or mixture femoral and radial. And also some operators use the parallel sheets technique, introducing by the femoral artery two sheets, 7 or 8, and 5 and 6. So for have optimal access for the coronary arteries, that is of most importance during the CTO procedure, many operators use the long arrow sheet 45 centimeters, but also we can use a wide variety of the guiding catheters. But looking at the procedural details from the EuroCTO Club data, we can see that we have a lot of use of contralateral injections. So does it mean that we should have a bilateral access? And in 2017, the bilateral access reached the contralateral injection reached about the 70%. So two-thirds of procedures are performed by two access. Why this access is important, you can see at this case that is the ostial RCA occlusion performed in the remote center without any control of the position of the wire. You can say this is the blinded angioplasty, and after positioning the wire somewhere, it was ballooning, and after this the operator try to find where his wire is and try injection two times a contrast, and this is the final result of this procedure, and we can set what is a beautiful catastrophe. But maybe such way is better than you if you have no visualization from the antegrade. You can use the retrograde injection and very simply control the way of the wire and to finish with such result. The another issue is the radial approach. The radial approach in our EuroCTO Club data was relatively stable, but we can see that last year it was a very big growth. Now we have more than 30, approximately 40% of the procedure performed with radial approach. This is our Polish data. In 2015, it was in Poland more than 124,000 PCI performed. From them, 2,200 CTO PCI. And 63% by the radial access. In all the patients with stable coronary artery disease, 80% of radial access. So the major concerns regarding the radial approach for unselected CTO is the feasibility of bilateral approach, as you saw that in two-thirds of patients, we need bilateral approach, and also the support for lesion crossing. We have taken into account the active and passive support of our guiding catheters, and also we should think about the need of the large guiding catheters for complex technique. So some familiarists comment that radial approach could be only used in the highly selected CTO cases. So for example, for middle AD, the short CTO with tapered morphology, or with homolateral or collateral circulation. This is our data from 2008-2013 from EuroCTO Club. You can see that about 11,500 procedure, and more than 2,300 performed by radial approach. And there is the same success rate, a little, surprisingly, a little longer duration of the procedure from femoral access, but the radiation dose higher in radial procedure. We can combine the radial and femoral approach. This is a case from my practice. You can see that I always use as a for the recognition for the anterograde approach the femoral access, and for the donor artery it was done by the radial approach. And you can see here, this is the right coronary occlusion and a very tortuous channel from the circumflex epicardial channel. I was able to cross it finally to externalize the wire and finish with the stenting. So we should remember that we go to the radial about the six French catheter compatibility that are mostly used during the procedure, and know which materials, which balloons, which technique, if you use IVUS or, for example, two cross, what can be accommodated by our guide wire. Here you can see the case of the cirque occlusion, the proximal cirque occlusion. I try to open this artery antegradely. It failed, so I found the way by the diagonal branch. You can see that it was passed, and the confirmation of the position, the contrast injection by the Corsair. And finally, I try to externalize the wire crossing from the back this artery. I tried to use the CAT technique, and was some surprise because the fellow who performed the angiography took six French, not seven French catheter, and was a problem how to finish this case. So finally, I try to externalize, and I was able to externalize the wire, but I cannot introduce, so it's, if you, this is the my impression during this case. And after that, I, as you can see, this is the RG-free. I remove all Corsair, so I left only RG-free in the artery. I cannot recommend such procedure, but I was able to perform to stent to balloon this artery with this final result. So always remember what you want to do and what your guiding catheter can accommodate. We have some papers, one in Eurointervention, looking at the details. What you can use having a six French catheter or seven or eight French catheter. And also we should in our practice, because we have some different manufacturers of guiding catheters, and you should try itself in your practice. If we are talking about the guiding catheters, there is no the best catheter for the CTO procedure. My favorites for the left is 7EB or Judkins left, but for the right also Amplatz left. So sometimes we should take the guiding with the side holes. And there are some patients that we cannot start with the radial approach. There are the patients when we have to use the eight French guiding catheter. So in the Eurostia Club data in 2012, it was 15% of such patients that eight French guide was used. We have some beautiful data. One is the most important patent by Bruzotta. They looked at all the publication for the transradial PCO in CTO lesion, not only published but also for the oral presentation during TCT and PCR, and they performed meta-analysis of this, and showing this is the learning curve. If you look at the five papers that it was divided for the first and second period of learning, is a better result are obtained in the second period. And for the direct comparison of the femoral and versus radial approach, the radial approach, the success rate was higher, but we should take into account that it was no randomized study, and we have to look at the complexity of the lesion. Probably for radial approach, the less complex lesion were chosen. So we should ask where we should place the more complexity of procedure with the learning steps and competency levels of the radial approach. Is this here at level 2, the PCI for stable clinical setting, including complex PCI, or on the top of those procedures? In this paper of Bruzzotta, we have also nicely describe the bench tests of the compatibility of CTO-PCI technique. I could not describe this in the details because it's a lot of data, but planning your procedure, you can look and take into account what your guiding catheter can accommodate. The other important study is the American study by the from the Contemporary Multicenter Registry, and they published those data 1 year ago. 1 year ago, 650 procedure, and the comparison between the transradial and transfemoral procedure, the number of transradial is 110. So there are in the clinical characteristic there is no big difference, but we should look at the percentage of the female. In overall group is only 13 of women, and in the transradial group in only 18. So it should be taken into account looking at those result. And the another is the if you look at those data, this, despite that it was made in very experienced American center, the data from the radial approach comes from only one center, from very experienced in this. But we have some interesting data that the JCTO score was even higher in transradial group, and the dual injection was used about half of the procedure. And this is details, the bilateral radial approach, 63% of also the combination of bilateral radial and femoral, and also the rest of the procedure. The technical success was very high for transradial approach, the same as for transfemoral, about 93%. And you can see there is no difference in vascular complication, but the group was too small to have a statistically significant data. The total procedure time was longer in the radial group, and also total fluoroscopy time and the air karma radiation, but not significantly. There was no difference between contrast volume, and the complication was the same. So now we are in the new, completely new era. We have completely new devices, and we can use for the CTO operation the sheetless catheter. Also, we have a new slender sheets when you can work with six French sheet with seven French guiding catheter, and there are some very useful technique for CTO PCI as a anchoring, not always with the balloon, but you can also, of course, use the guide wire for anchoring, and also this special manipulation with the guiding catheter to have a better support, a better stability. In general, it's better to use the right radial approach to the left coronary system and left radial artery to the RCA. It gives you better support, better coaxial alignment. And going to finish my talk, we should talk about the condition when the radial artery access is critically important for the success of the PCI. It's the group of post-CABG patients when CTO-PCI requires more than two arterials access, when we have a need of hemodynamic support device via common femoral artery. Of course, the group with peripheral artery occlusion of the aorta, iliac, or common femoral arteries, and also the patients at high risk for femoral access complication, so especially women. The common femoral artery access should be preferred during CTO-PCI when we don't have the radial artery, when the radial artery cannot accommodate a six French introducer, when we have such anatomic variation that prevent radial artery crossing with the wire of the guiding catheter or very significant subclavian or brachiocephalic tortuosity in patients who may need permanent hemodialysis access, or also sometimes said that in very proximal chronic or ostial occlusion also is better to have femoral access. So let me to conclude. Transradial access for chronic total coronary occlusion treatment is feasible and could be very useful in selected patients and clinical situation. In my opinion, transfemoral approach still remains the gold standard for complex CTO lesion and retrograde technique. Routine transradial approach should be limited to operators and center very experienced in both CTO recanalization and in transradial approach. So we need the prospective randomized control study that would be very important to better define the optimal access selection. I would like to invite you next week. We have the experts live workshop in Krakow, and in the program we have provide also the debate pro and contra between the femoral and radial approach. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you very much again. We apologize for the lack of questions because we're a little bit behind. But.
Okay, so we can go on with next presentation by Dr. Ricari. It's a brachial contrapulsation to support complex transradial PCI, please.
Yeah, thank you very much. I want to talk about the slender IABP today. Background. Slender system is good for patients, but bad for operators. Many operators don't like it. But which is important? We believe that slender transradial PCI is the best. And Slender Club Japan has developed slender techniques and devices like this. And also, we have reported limitations. So many devices are gone, unfortunately. This is a 10-balloon system. Very small one, 10 wire, and the distal tip is 12. It's smaller than the regular wire, so crossability is very nice. And also, we can insert two balloon and two wires into the 5 French guiding catheter and 3 into 6 French guiding catheter. So Dr. Yoshimachi reported 5 French kissing balloon technique, and Dr. Matsukage reported 6 French King Ghidorah technique. It's a three balloons. It's a three-headed monster. It's a King Ghidorah. And also, we did a real-world registry, but it showed balloon was very nice. However, 10-inch guide wire was too weak to deliver a regular stent. So you can see to deliver stent system, eight was impossible to deliver stent. Very weak guide wire. So this is a limitation. This is a virtual three French system. And this is a Medikit Works system, so you can insert the 5-French guiding catheter without sheath, puncture, and 18-inch guide wire, and then into a dilator, it's a 3-French compatible one, and insert a 2.5-inch guide wire, it's a long one to the ascending aorta. Then you can insert a 5-French guiding catheter. I use a IKI left because it can go to left and right, so sheathless is not a problem. And virtual 3-French is reported by Dr. Yoshimachi this afternoon, and he will talk about the limitation of the virtual 3-French system. Next one is, this is a 3-French diagnostic catheter, and if you insert this catheter without sheath, it is a virtual 1-French, and it is smaller than the 18-gauge needle, almost 19-gauge. But you need a power injector. Hand injection is a little bit difficult, but not so fat patient, we can do a diagnostic procedure. And this is very small, and actually I asked nurse, how much time do you need with a 20-gauge needle A-line? She said, 5 minutes. So I challenged her, I want to stop 4 minutes, okay? Actually, this is my hand. I always use a TR band or something, but this is for movie. I did my hand in 4 minutes, and it stopped. And patient said, this is real no pain procedure compared with prior catheter procedures. So they are very happy. However, Terumo gave up sales because manufacturing cost was higher than the sales cost. So it's gone. Actually, it was a very nice device. And now, Terumo is now selling the Glide Sheath Slender. It's a very nice system. And actually, Dr. Yoshimachi and Slender Club Japan people asked many companies to make it, but many companies said no because thin wall is fragile, but only Terumo could make it. It's a technology. And now we are using the 5-French, 6-French, 7-French Glide Sheath Slender. Now I want to talk about today's topic, IABP. Transradial approach with slender catheter has advantages. However, cardiac assist device such as IABP is big, so it may cancel the benefit of slender TRI. And this is a 6-French IABP system. So 6-French, very nice. However, there are several limitations. One is a guide wire is a 14-inch, small one. So it's difficult to insert sometimes. And only 30 milliliter type, no 40. And catheter length is short. So there are several limitations. But we can apply this one from brachial because it's 6-French. But not impossible from radial because the catheter length is short. So in some cases, IABP is necessary, but no femoral approach site. Brachial approach is maybe beneficial compared with femoral approach due to no need to keep the supine position. And we know the limitation of median nerve injury due to the brachial approach. And brachial approach size was 4.5 millimeter in Japanese patients. So size is okay for 6-French. And this is IABP. And also this is only 14-inch wire lumen, so we cannot monitor blood pressure. It's impossible. And this blood pressure is monitored by a guiding catheter, not the IABP sheath, and it works as a IABP pressure. And after the procedure, it's a prophylactic use. We remove this one in the cath lab. Using a compression device, it is okay. And we published the initial result in 2012 to show the clinical outcomes of 6-French IABP. and we included 42 PCI cases, and six French transbrachial 15, six French transfemoral IVP number is 5, and I will show the data compared 6 French versus 8 French. It means 20 versus 22. And transbrachial and transfemoral, it's a 15 versus 27. So I will show the data. So don't be confused. And this is the end points. And using the slender 6 French IVPs, their medical and 8 French is a data scope. And this is a 6 French versus 8 French IVP. There is no significant difference in the baseline characteristics. And most of the PCI was a left main related procedure. No emergency cases, elective, prophylactic use. And guiding catheter size is actually 6 French is a 6, and IVP volume is a 30, and actuation times a little longer, but others are no difference. And you can show IVP access site complication is 0 using the 6 French IVP, but statistically no significant difference. Only difference was found the bed rest time after PCI. It's significantly shorter in 6 French. And this is a 6 French transbrachial, 6 French transfemoral, and 8 French transfemoral analysis. And you can see the delta hematocrit percent is lower, so bleeding is smaller. And also platelet reduction is smaller. And bed rest time after PCI in the transbrachial IVP is 0 because we do the PCI in the transradial approach. So summary is we studied clinical benefits and adverse events of the 6 French IVP system by comparison with the conventional 8 French IVP system. No adverse events were observed in the 6 French IVP. The 6 French IVP system was superior to 8 French IVP in terms of shorter bed rest time. Transbrachial was superior to transfemoral in terms of shorter bed rest time and shorter hospital stay. But always say limitations. It's not randomized study and retrospective studies, small sample, and only prophylactic cases. And device limitation is only 30 milliliter. Tip pressure is not available, and transbrachial insertion is off-label use. In case of drawback of the IVP catheter, it may cause injury on subclavian artery. It's a big disaster. And radial artery are not available because the catheter is too short. And also, in case of subclavian occlusion, it's difficult to insert. And also, so-called type 3 arch is very difficult to insert. So 6 French IVP system will be feasible in clinical use and advantageous in terms of lower access site complications. Transbrachial application will be also possible using this system to achieve shorter bed rest time and shorter hospital stay. But you have to be careful of several limitations. Thank you very much for your attention.
Presentation. Do you use sometimes a closing device for brachial access?
No, just compression. Type hemostasis device, no closure device.
Who is using some closing device for brachial access?
I have to admit, I don't remember last time I did brachial access. And, it's really been a while. Mm. All right, I'm going to move to the next one.
Thank you very much. We ask Dr. Sidak to come to present data from the ORCHI registry showing the benefits of radial approach in STEMI patients.
Dear committee, dear auditory, my name is Tomasz Tokarek. I'm instead of Dr. Szwidak, and I'm honored to present results of our study. I do not declare any potential conflict of interest regarding this presentation. the utilization of radial access for percutaneous coronary intervention has gradually increased. Recent studies suggest an advantage of a femoral access in high-risk patients with ST segment elevation, myocardial infarction, although technically more demanding radial access has been recently demonstrated as feasible in the STEMI settings. The aim of the study was to evaluate bleeding complications and peri-procedure outcomes with safety and efficacy of radial approach compared with femoral approach for PCI with stent implantation in real-world patients with STEMI presentation from Polish National Registry. 22,812 consecutive patients with STEMI treated with PCI and stent implantations between January 2014 and June 2015 in 151 tertiary invasive cardiology centers in Poland were enrolled to this analysis. Nearly 60% of the patients were treated with radial approach. The rest of the patients underwent PCI with femoral access. To avoid potential influence of the differences in baseline patient characteristic, propensity score match analysis was done. After the calculation, 6,542 matched pairs were created. After propensity match score analysis, there was no significant differences in the baseline patient characteristic between the radial approach and the femoral approach group. Also, there was no significant differences in angiographic indications for PCI with stent implantations between analyzed groups, and there was no significant differences in the percent of patients with target lesion, in particular vessel, in comparison between radial and femoral approach. Flow through the artery in TIMI class was no significant difference between radial and femoral approach before the PCI. However, after the PCI, significantly more patients from radial approach was classified as TIMI 3. Significantly more radiation dose and lower contrast volume were used in radial approach in comparison with the patients treated with femoral access. Also, fractional flow reserve and aspiration thrombectomy were significantly more often used during the PCI with radial approach utilization. Patients treated with radial access were significantly more often treated with prasugrel loading dose during the PCI. Also glycoprotein 2B3A inhibitors and low molecular weight heparins were significantly more often used in the patients with radial access. Patients with radial access were had significantly lower ratio of bleeding at both puncture site during the hospitalization and after the PCI. Also, periprocedural death and periprocedural cardiac arrest after PCI occurred significantly less frequently in the patients treated with radial access utilization. However, allergic reaction was reported significantly more often in the patients with radial access utilization. In conclusion, radial approach was associated with lower incidence of periprocedural death in STEMI patients. There was also significant reduction of bleeding complications and access site both during hospitalization and after the PCI in the radial approach group. Periprocedural cardiac arrest was significantly less frequently reported after the PCI with radial approach, and more allergic reaction was reactions occurred in radial approach group. Thank you for your attention.
I think this is great data. I really congratulate you on putting this together as a national registry. I've actually two questions. One is, do you have the difference of shock in patients between radial and femoral
access? Once again,
the difference in shock, the Kilib class?
Yes, we didn't present this data. Actually, there was no significant differences between both groups.
Yeah, and I have to say your femoral bleeding rates are also pretty low. I think they're very, very nice.
Actually, regarding to this data, there is problems because the more reliable data are during the bleedings, complications after the PCI. Because when the data is starting to be written to the database, it's usually after the PCI directly, and some bleeding complications during the hospitalization might be missed because of the time of the data supplementation to the database.
Thank you.
So that might be the reason.
You mean that in case of a cardiogenic shock, you use also transradial access easily?
Actually, I cannot tell you the exact data, but there is no significant differences. I can't remember right now the differences in the Kimball classification, but there was no significant.
In the interest of time, we would like to reserve the questions towards the end of the session. I would like to call on Dr. Kwok as the next speaker regarding his topic, access site choice and risk adverse neurologic events. Dr. Kwok.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, panelists, chairman. My name is Shen Kwok. Sorry about the delay, but thank you for the opportunity to speak to you about access choice for cardiac catheterization and risk of adverse neurological complications. So stroke is a feared complication after cardiac catheterization. There are two types of stroke, ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. Fortunately, this is a rare event, but when it happens, it's catastrophic. In large registries, incidents of stroke have been recorded as one in about 1,000, and in the context of PCI, it's higher at about 2 to 4 per 1,000. And we've shown from analysis of the British Cardiovascular Intervention Society database that if you sustain a stroke in the context of PCI, you're at an increased risk of adverse cardiovascular events as well as mortality. And other studies have shown that there is prolonged hospitalization as well as medical costs. Because of this, studies have looked at potential reasons why stroke may occur in the context of PCI, and the mechanism is believed to be related to arterial embolization. And studies have suggested that catheter exchanges, so the more catheters you use, you're more likely to dislodge emboli, cause vascular trauma. At the same time, the caliber of the catheters you use, larger caliber, more likely to cause trauma. And there's this theoretical mechanism where if you go via the right radial artery, you could cross the brachial cephalic artery and cause trauma and dislodge emboli and cause stroke, which is higher than compared to going left radial. So I think Prof. Nolan showed this slide before, but radial access has become the default access choice for PCI and cardiac catheterization in the UK. Rates have gone astonishingly from 10% in 2004 to 70% in 2014. And this is mainly because of reduced mortality, bleeding, and adverse outcomes. However, there are still some people who are familiar who are resistant to changing to the radio access. So one of their reasons for this is they think there's increased risk of adverse neurological events. So a previous meta-analysis was done, published by Patel et al. In the International Journal of Cardiology. And what they showed was that there was no difference between going radial access and femoral access in terms of stroke events. However, since the study published in 2013, there have been newer studies published, so we updated this review. So we performed a systematic review and meta-analysis. Our inclusion criteria was radial and femoral access for cardiac catheterization. We're interested in studies which reported stroke or subclinical neurological events. And we required that each study had to have some form of numbers, whether it's crude numbers or a risk ratio, odds ratio, so we can pool the results together. We performed a search of Medline Embase in September 2015. And we divide our search into three parts: the population, which is those who undergo angiography, cardiac angiography, or PCI, and terms related to exposure, which is transradial or transfemoral access, and the outcomes of interest, which are neurological events or stroke. We then performed independent double, two people independently screened and extracted the data, and we performed meta-analysis using Review Manager, using the Mantel-Hensel method. This is a flow diagram which showed our search results yielded 979 results, and just by screening the titles and the abstracts, we were able to exclude more than 800. We reviewed 133 in detail, and many of the studies didn't actually report results, or they were duplicate studies, but in the end, we were left with 36 studies met the inclusion criteria. So a lot of people, when they show meta-analysis, they'll just show the forest plot as I've done earlier on without considering actually the studies. And this is really important. So this is a table which summarizes a lot of information about studies, because the results you get depends on the individual studies themselves and how they differ. So in this table, we show that we find that there's a very lot of differences in the types of studies. Some are RCTs, some are prospective cohorts, some are retrospective cohorts. They've taken place all over the world and across different years, and practice has changed over time. And also the sample size varies. Some are very underpowered, less than 100 patients, while others are thousands of patients, more adequately powered. And the cohorts themselves vary. Some are much older, some are younger, some are more males, and some are specific cohorts, like STEMI cohorts, while others are diagnostic cases as well as interventional cases. Another really important part of meta-analysis is actually quality assessment. So there's some groups endorse particular scales, like for observational studies, people can use Ottawa Newcastle, or Cochrane suggests using their method of assessing bias through trials. But we've included both trials and observational data, so we designed our own risk of bias assessment. And so studies that are randomized controlled trials or prospective were deemed to be higher quality. Studies with larger sample sizes were deemed to be higher quality. And also the way they assessed outcomes, the neurological events. Did they scan every patient? Did they just look for admissions with stroke? That's another indicator of quality. As well as loss to follow-up, as missing data you can't account for for the results. And also for observational studies, you need to adjust for baseline differences, for potential confounding, and randomized trials. If there are baseline differences, this could be a source of bias. So here are some results. We've just summarized the population as well as the outcomes and when it was assessed, as well as the actual events in this table. So a lot of people just show a forest plot, but one thing that you really need to consider is actually the event rates. Sometimes they don't always show this. So the event rate should match with the results you see. And in this population of about almost 500,000 patients, 250,000 undergoing radial and 250,000 going femoral, you find that the rate of stroke in the radial group is 0.14%, and the rate in the femoral group is 0.19%. So there's fewer events in the radial access group. And this translates into a reduced risk in both the randomized trials on top, as well as the cohort studies. We did further sub-analysis considering ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic strokes separately. There were fewer studies, but the results are largely the same. There's no increase in events by going radial access for both ischemic and hemorrhagic stroke. Some limitations. This is a review. You're always at risk of publication bias. So the quality of the data we present is dependent on the data's out in literature. If the literature is biased because only positive results are published, then there could be some biases in what we present. However, we've tried to reduce this by searching Embase, which includes conference abstracts. Another limitation is that some of the studies have small sample sizes, and you might not capture enough stroke events. There's also the possibility of subclinical lesions, so the ideal study may be to scan everyone's head, but that's practically not feasible. And there's also unmeasured confounding, particularly in the cohort studies. there may be selection biases why people may choose to go with radial access over femoral access. And this is also not an individual patient meta-analysis, which seems to be a trend these days, where people actually request data from all the groups and then they do a new analysis. We conclude that there's no evidence that radial access is associated with adverse neurological events. And these previously expressed concerns, mainly from femoralists, that there's more neurological events with radial access is not evidence-based. And our study provides reassurance of this in quantitative terms. Thank you very much, and these are my references.
Thank you for this very nice presentation. In case of a patient with CABG, do we have a higher rate of strokes?
That's an interesting question. We haven't looked at that. I think one of the problems is that the event rates are so low. Even in 250,000 patients, you only have a few hundred events. So in the CABG population, is probably even smaller than that within the group. So if there were larger studies or with lots of CABG patients, it's probably worth looking into, but we don't have that data.
I think this is great data because it really reassures everybody that radial is safe. I think that's really fantastic, and I think it's good that we continue showing this to the femoral community. We looked, but the question that interests me, I think it still doesn't explain the mechanism of stroke, right? You know, and I think I looked in one study retrospectively in the U.S., 1.5 million PCIs, and it seems to be stable over time. It just doesn't seem to change. Even if you do 2B3A, no 2B3A, bivalirudin comes in or not, so it's something we don't fully understand. You know, but as long as radial is as good as femoral, I think that's perfect.
I have a question.
Oh, yes.
To your knowledge, which is the time limit to consider a stroke related to PCI procedure or angiographic procedure?
Yeah, that's a tricky question because I guess for the trials, they have more rigorous monitoring of stroke events. So they'll know exactly when the stroke occurs. But for the registries, it's in hospitals. You don't know if they sustained the stroke right after the event or if it could have been weeks down the line for whatever reason. Unfortunately, we don't have the original data from each of the studies to answer that question. But that's definitely something to explore in the future. Very good question. We are actually planning to do some analysis related to that, but we haven't shown that in this case, and we haven't finished the analysis at this time.
Louder, please.
We're planning to do that with the BSIS registry. That's what Professor Mammis said. Maybe we'll present that at a later time. Thank you.
There doesn't seem to be any difference, at least based on current data. The left is, as their incidence of stroke seems the same, so I think some other events, femoral, left, right, it's something else going on rather than, I think, access choice.
We have another question.
Thank you for your presentation. I have a comment. There is a tendency in transradial operators that now that we have a low rate of vascular complication, we can use anticoagulants or anticoagulants more. And we have two cases of hemorrhagic stroke.
Okay, let's move to the next presentation. A high-risk transradial PCI with an impeller assist device support from Dr. Leon.
good morning. My name is Abel León from Madrid, and I show you the serious case of four patients with high-risk transradial PCI with Impella device support. In our hospital in Puerta de Hierro of Madrid, we are performing a total of 22 complex PCIs with support of Impella ventricular assist device. In four patients, we have used the combined approach and radial and femoral. In this case report, we present the characteristic and the results of the four patients treated with this combined approach. This is a brief of the history of the four patients. The four were male and have a lot of risk factors. The four have an history of ischemic cardiomyopathy and have a ventricular dysfunction, multivessel disease, and some of them unreversible vessels. And in the different types of context of the patients, stable angina, progressive or unstable angina, and patient with acute pulmonary edema. These patients have in common severe systolic dysfunction, multivessel disease, and it was necessary to carry out a complex PCI. And then, if the patient have two or three parameters, and then we use the Impella assist device. This is just a view of the lesions. One patient and a severe and heavily calcified stenosis in the right coronary artery. Patient two with a severe and long stenosis in the LID with previous cavity and total occlusion in the right coronary artery. Another patient with a total occlusion in the right coronary artery and severe stenosis and long stenosis in the LID and the circumflex. And the next patient, the last patient, with a heavily calcified right coronary artery with a focal stenosis, but with a total occlusion of the LID, and this is the last patent vessel. The common aspect in these four patients, well, the transfemoral access was used to place the Impella 2.5 assist device, and the transradial access was used to perform the PCIs. The rotational atherectomy was used finally performed in patient one. In our patient was necessary, like a complex PCI, the predilatation with no compliant balloons with progressive diameters. In patient three and four, was it necessary to use a gadolinium to advance the balloons and the stents to do the PCI. And during the inflation of the balloons, because of our patient with severe systolic dysfunction, there was a transient drop in the blood pressure, but due to the Impella assist device support, it was maintained the stability, the hemodynamical stability of the patient. Another, the tortuosity and the calcification sometimes present in both femoral and radial access and support. This is the rotational atherectomy in patient one with the Impella assist device. This was the use of the gadolinium to advance the stent in the LID in patient three, and in patient four was necessary to use to advance the stent to the right coronary artery. This is the hemodynamic response during the PCI, during the ischemia, but in the procedures, during the inflation of the balloons, during the use of the gadolinium, and then this allowed to achieve a more stability during the patients, during the procedures. Sorry. And then this is the final results of the four patients. To the LID. In this patient was treated the circumflex and the LID. And the right coronary artery. So, what are the conclusion of the thesis point of this presentation? Well, the selection of the vascular access is important in the planning of the complex PCIs. The trend, at least in our hospital, is to use the femoral approach in these procedures. In patients with left ventricular dysfunction, multiversus disease, procedures to the last patent vessel or the left main artery, we use the Impella ventricular assist device to minimize the bad responses to the and tolerances to the ischemia. The hemodynamical support with Impella allows transradial procedures, which sometimes involve major technical maneuvers because it has less support, and then we use another material than a femoral approach. Transradial compress PCI is feasible to carry out and thereby reduce the vascular complication by avoiding a bilateral femoral puncture. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any questions? I have a question. Do you use, for the panel or the room, do you use such hemodynamic assistance before doing a complex PCI in your practice?
Yeah, so this would actually be our practice, Impella and radial, I think, because you take at least one groin out of the equation, right? You don't have two femoral axes, you have one. So it actually worked well for us. One question I had for you is, how do you do this? Impella first, then the guide, or guide first, then the Impella? Or
Impella first.
Yeah.
This is a planned procedure. None of them was in emergency procedure, and then Impella first, and later the...
Yeah, that's a good trick I was going to say, is because sometimes if you do guide first and then Impella, then you regret it, because especially the amplets guide, you can flip them out. So that'd be my tip and trick, Impella first and the guide.
Do you use pre-closing devices for the Impella, the axis, or the femoral access, pre-closing devices, such as the TAVI?
Perclose.
Any question?
I think we could think. Thank you. All right, and then we'll conclude with a case from Dr. Schäufele, who is also the radialist of the year from the award last night. We'll hear about the CTO with an epicardial artery to a single guide.
Well, good morning, Mr. Chairman, dear panelists, dear colleagues. It's an extraordinary pleasure and honor to give this talk among such a renowned and nice community. And as long as this one was not only, or is not only a talk, it was also part of a kind of competition, I would like to allow myself to commence before I start. First of all, I had a closer look to all these clinical cases. And I was really impressed by the previous case. I was impressed by the transradial embolization of the prostate, and I have to admit that I'm happy that I was not in the shoes of the committees to choose which was the most exciting one, because I think this must have been a true photo finish. The second comment, trying to establish a radio program and a CTO program is only always a team approach, and so this award does clearly not go only to the presenter, but this goes definitely to the whole team. So the case that I want to present today, here are my disclosures. I'm a poor guy, so I'm sorry I do not have many of them. Deals about a 76 years old woman. She presented to our hospital with a medical story of de novo angina starting back in 2015. She was treated by her general practitioner with medical therapy, and she came back to us with a stable angina on this optimal medical therapy, systematically reproducible under stress. Her coronary status so far was unknown. She had no known history of myocardial infarction. Among her cardiovascular risk factors, there was a hypercholesterolemia. She was an ex-smoker. She gave up smoking about 15 years ago. and she suffered from arterial hypertension. What was interesting and something that fell back on our shoes later was she had a peripheral artery disease with a Fontan status 2A. So to wrap up the clinical presentation, we deal with a stable but recurrent angina. Despite optimal medical therapy, she had a significant risk profile, and so along to current guidelines, we went straight ahead to invasive testing, and she received a coronary angiography. So what we found was a severely diseased right coronary artery, and this was performed as a standard with a Tiger catheter, and we also found a left coronary artery with a severe disease. There was one lesion in the proximal LAD, and with a closer look to the angiogram, there was a completely occluded marginal branch, which can nicely be seen here where the yellow arrows are. So in the second angulation in the cranial LAO, it was clear that there was a total occlusion of the side branch, but we dealt with a large marginal branch. And this could be once again visualized in this LAD, in this RAO caudal projection, and it was evident that we have to deal with a chronic total occlusion. So what happened next? When we deal with chronic occlusions, we have the opportunity that we have our own MRI scanner. We perform about 3,500 cardiac MRIs per year, and we have regular access, so all those patients with chronic total occlusion receive a cardiac MRI, and the MRI revealed nicely a normal wall motion in the lateral wall, but as you may appreciate from this picture, we can see that there's a large zone of ischemia in this darker area here, but on the other hand, as we can see from the late gadolinium enhancement, there's basically no or only little amount of scar. Definitely it is less than 50%, and so the patient will, taking the current data into consideration, will definitely profit from a revascularization of this area. So we took the patient to our multidisciplinary team. We deal with a three vessel disease, but as long as MRI did not reveal any ischemia in the LAD territory, it is functional two vessel disease. The syntax score was calculated with a 21.3, the STS score of mortality with 1.1%. So when is a patient referred from the surgeons to the interventionalist? Usually when health freezing over. But in this case, the patient's wish was definitely to go for intervention. And along with the syntax score below 23, we were able to do this with a really good consciousness. And recommendation was to go for PCI. So what was the challenge? The challenge of the case was this only transradial access was possible, and or was the best, seemed to be the best choice, I have to be honest. I'm a 95% transradial operator, but I'm a near 100% femoral operator for CTOs. I usually do a kind of hybrid version that means the donor artery, like Professor Bryansky showed before. For the donor artery, we use the transradial access, but for the access site for the recanalization, we use the transfemoral access. And we only had ipsilateral collaterals. There were no collaterals from the right coronary artery. And what gave an additional problem that there was no palpable pulse on the left coronary artery. So instead of choosing two guides from the very beginning for a ping pong maneuver, we chose only one single six French guide. The six French guide was because it was a rather tiny lady, and the right radial artery was not that large. And the first step was an antegrade approach with a parallel wire. And what you can nicely appreciate here is we used an EBO 3.5 without sight holes. And the standard approach is fine cross with a Fielder XT. And the Fielder XT failed to get to the true lumen. So I left it in place, switched to the parallel wire technique, and I used the Gaia second, but this Gaia second also went to the wrong lumen. So how to proceed? There was evidently a very nice interventional, for intervention usable collateral that went from the apex epicardially around the whole lateral wall back to the RCX, and I decided to go this way. So this is the Corsair catheter, and the Corsair catheter was inserted over a BMW, and then my standard wire for retrograde sedation of septal epicardial collaterals is the C on black, and this was the way to go. So this seems rather easy. In fact, it was not. The Sion went, it did a kind of sightseeing. It went nearly in every side branch that was possible. But finally, I was able to go to the right channel. And it was very easy to puncture the distal cap with a Confianza Pro 9 and go back to the anterograde part of the RCX with the Gaia second still in place. Now the problem was with a six French catheter, it was definitely not possible to trap in an externalized balloon. So what I tried to do is I tried to do a direct tip in of the Confianza Pro 9 into the anterograde inserted fine cross catheter here. And I tried this for about 15 minutes and it was flatly impossible because due to the long way that the collateral did here and due to the configuration, it was bouncing around, it was flatly impossible to get into the fine cross catheter. But finally I was happy, and it was very easy to advance the retrograde Confianza into the anterograde guide, and the friction of the Corsair was little enough to get the Corsair fully advanced into the guide, into the anterior guide, and so I was able to externalize an RG3 wire and continue with the procedure after giving up the externalization from the anterograde way. And this is the final result that you can appreciate here. We see a large vessel. It was finally stented with two synergy stents. And in fact, this is a picture that I've obtained 4 weeks later. And now the question is, why 4 weeks later? We did the right coronary artery in the same session. But the patient came back 4 weeks to follow up and she still complained for chest pain. And what has happened, the lesion in the proximal LAD that failed to show a significant ischemia in the MRI was highly significant with the FFR that we measured in the same setting. And so we did an intervention of the proximal LAD as well. So finally the patient turned out to be a true three-vessel disease and the procedure was finished. So to summarize, I think this case nicely shows that transradial access is a valuable option for CTO procedures like Professor Briansky showed before. Low-profile material allows us for complicated procedures, and I chose the Corsair at this time because the Carol was not yet available. Now we have the Carol, which is even smaller than the Corsair. And sometimes ipsilateral collaterals are often the only way to go, the only way to go and to achieve your goal. I think appropriate patient selection is mandatory. CMR is useful in order to rule out a transmural scar, but may fail to show anterior ischemia of the proximal LAD, and FFR might yield higher sensitivity compared to MRI in the mid-LAD. I think physiologic assessment combined with a multidisciplinary team approach combined with transradial access in a case like this yields optimal individual results. Thank you for your attention.
Congratulations on your very challenging case.
Thank you.
Would you consider doing coronary CT angio first to evaluate the CTO?
We do this in some cases. When we have a very, very long occlusion where we do not have a really good idea how the original vessel really goes, especially for the right coronary artery, we do the CT scans, and sometimes it helps. There is some data published by Gerald Werner who nicely demonstrates that in his case he sees an additional benefit. But on the other hand, he has a nice merging software that can merge the CT scan with the angiography, and I think it's still a kind of better version provided by Siemens. So in our daily routine, it's sometimes it's useful, but we do not do it regularly.
I have another question for you. Congratulations for the excellent demonstration. My doubt is, if you had performed FFR on LAD before surgery, before discussion with the art team, would you have what do you think the patient would have undergo surgery in your institution, or you have would have done PCI the same?
As a matter of fact, due to our TAVI program, we have a very good heart team, and we work really closely together. That means we really can discuss with our surgeon, because usually once the patient is with the surgeons, he will stay with the surgeons. But in this case, I think it was the wish of the patient to go for an intervention if possible. And I have to admit that with an LAD lesion in this case, the syntax score had been higher than 23. So the advice should have been go for surgery. But I think that's always the case. If you have an individual wish of a patient, it's only an advice. So if the patient says, I refuse and I decline surgery, I think we had done exactly the same that we have done now. What I always do when we have such complex cases, we always treat the most complex, in this case, the CTO lesion first. Because if you fail to reopen the CTO, that's a clear case for surgery.
Yeah, it just shows you. I had a discussion yesterday with Dr. Pancholi about this. It just shows you how annoying our stress modalities are, right?
Yeah.
Stress echo is not good. Nuclear is not good. You're showing us that MRI, meaning you have a great example of lateral ischemia, and still wasn't good either, right? And so
yep.
That definitely shows you that cath, coronary angiography, and FFR may be the best we have.
Yeah, absolutely. I completely agree.
It's a properly performed MRI. You have everything. You have late enhancement. You have stress, and it's still. Still failed us. Right?
Yeah, what we discovered during the last 2 years, that especially the LAD is tricky, because it depends on the algorithm that you use for the MRI. So LAD might definitely be missed.
We saw that the diameter of the guiding catheter was a problem in this procedure. Do you have any experience of a sheathless guiding?
We use the sheathless guide for left ventricular myocardial biopsy, transradial biopsy. I usually don't use it for other purposes. The problem is just if you have to exchange it, it's a little bit annoying. and you lose the extra backup that you have with the sheath. I think the sheathless catheter, they're slipping in and out, so it's a little bit, especially in a case like this where you depend on every kind of backup that you have, I prefer a regular catheter.
And the tip is quite stiff.
Yeah.
Any comment or question in the room? We are waiting for the live case from China.
Okay.
Maybe
thank
it's
you.
Already now. To see the results.
Sorry. the incidence is very low, so it's impossible to show, to demonstrate anything. But I think that avoiding right radial in elderly, very elderly patients above 75 years old or with history of carotid disease, I think it should be interesting in order to avoid, reduce the rate of stroke.
I do have some personal interest in this stroke, and it's interesting is because you would think if it's thrombotic that the radial would be less, right? Because we give consistently anticoagulation with radial and we don't give it for femoral, but again, it doesn't pan out. So, Manas, do you have a...
was a reduction in the use of glycoprotein 2B3A inhibitors. In contrast, the ischemic strokes have increased over time, and the main driver for that are the demographic profiles of the patients and how they've changed over time. So in the UK, the patients on average have become older, they've become more comorbid, and that drives the stroke complication rate. And the second most important factor was the indication for PCI. In the UK, as in most of the world, we've switched from mainly an elective setting to an ACS indication. Another thing that we found that was quite interesting was actually thrombectomy in primary PCI was a very strong predictor of ischemic complications, which tied in with some of the observations from the TOTAL trial as well.
It may well go down now that we have total data published that actually the stroke will likely go down, and we learned that that was a risk factor, at least a modifiable risk factor.
So another anatomical factor to consider is that a lot of the strokes arise from the catheter's traverse in the arch of the aorta. So if you go up the leg, you're quite likely to dislodge atheroma from the arch. If you go down the right arm, you will bypass most of that area. If you go in the left arm, you will traverse that high embolic risk area. So there's lots of factors that interplay, you know, and result in strokes. It's not a very easy thing to try and work out what the mechanism is in most people.
Yeah, and meaning what we really need is a prospective study with an MRI, I mean, to look at this, because very all of these, you know, you need a huge N, right? You need millions because of flow. So you need a lot of power, and none of these events are truly nicely adjudicated, right?
No.
So this is all registry,
yeah,
very low quality data.
Yeah.
So there was a study with transcranial Doppler, and that study was in favor of femoral, let's say.
Days when number groups started going radial, there was a slight increase of strokes, but it's a very, very small number. And then after they learned, then it stabilized and then went down. And we saw that again when the second wave of radialists came along. So it, in SCAR, it looks like it could be related to the very early phases of people learning doing radials.
It was very criticized.
last case was a very interesting one, CTO through epicardial collaterals. But what was more interesting for me was that the speaker does myocardial biopsy through radial route and from LV with sheathless guiding catheter. Will you please explain more?
Well, this is a rather simple procedure that we've published last year and in clinical research in cardiology. And we basically use a 7.5 sheathless MP1 catheter. And we have a series of nearly 160 patients right now. Complication rate is below the complication rate that we have from transfemoral, because transfemoral, there's many, smaller samples than you can obtain with a transradial, because the maneuverability of the catheter is far better than a sheath, and it's a very nice procedure if you're interested in left ventricular biopsy.
So I had just a question, because we had this discussion yesterday. But just who does arterial ventricular biopsy in the room? One, two, three, I guess, right? You know, and then the rest would be venous, right? Right ventricular biopsy. It's an interesting approach, I gotta say. I think we can't get into China. I think
that's not possible. And we'll have a live from France, from Grenoble, Benjamin Faury. So maybe we have to change the panel for the next session, and go to Grenoble for the live case. Brilliant. Thank you very much for this session. It was really amazing and interesting. Thank you.
You.